in an organised way, in a legal way, in a way that threatens no one else, no matter how distasteful I might find those views, they have a right to do it. And that's what I would defend. But that isn't what happened in this case. The Mayor of Liverpool, not a great friend of mine, this is quite obvious, received an absolutely vile letter. That letter was followed up by emails to potential supporters of the organisation when they were asked to come here, which made it absolutely clear they didn't want to have a debate, they didn't want to exercise free speech. What they wanted was trouble. They wanted a fight. Because that's the only way 10 or 12 people can get any attention. Marching through Liverpool, 10 or 12 people, even the most outrageous banners wouldn't cut it. They wanted a fight. I agree that we need to change the law, but even if that happens, it's not going to happen quickly. So we need to consider what we're going to do if this happens again. But we cannot pay £50,000 every time a bunch of pranks threaten our city. And I believe, that I do slightly disagree with what Councillor Crowe said, because I believe there was an overreaction to 12 people, nasty and vile though they might be. I believe the way we deal with these people is to ridicule them. They are clowns, they are stupid, they are thick. But sending 2,000 people on the streets to march against them actually gave them the credibility and the flame of oxygen that they require. So what I would suggest in future is that if such things are threatened, we all get together to come up with what is an appropriate...
Councillor Kemp, could you finish your now?
I'm finishing on this sentence. That we come together to come up with what is an appropriate response, not an overkill, which will actually defeat our aims in trying to deal with this issue. I oppose it.
Councillor Small.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I also want to oppose this amendment. And last month, along with many other colleagues of all parties and none, I was proud to stand beside United Against Fascism to oppose the White Man March in this city and to say, not in my name and not in this city's name. But I think the response to that demonstrates that the current position simply isn't good enough. Under the Public Order Act, we don't have the kind of powers that we need to be able to say, not in my name, and to be able to deal with this in an adequate way. Under those powers, the Chief Constable can impose conditions on a march. They can only ban a march if there's a serious threat of public order. Well, what about those marches, those hate-filled marches that are about nothing else but spreading hate in our city, which don't quite meet that threshold of public order? What about those marches? Because the Chief Constable does not have the power that he needs to be able to address those marches and to protect the citizens of this city in an adequate way. And what this motion will do is ask him for powers to apply only where the march has a singular focus of hatred and bigotry. Nowhere else, and that's absolutely right. The mayor, council leaders shouldn't be able to ban marches that they simply don't like. It should only apply in those restricted circumstances, which is what this motion says. And there is the protection of a right to appeal to the Home Secretary, and again, that is absolutely right. So only in those restricted circumstances, and only when the Secretary of State, the Home Secretary, says that that's right on appeal, should a council leader and a mayor have those new powers. Because what we have at the moment simply isn't adequate. And the groups that I spoke to from the Jewish community, from BME organisations, and actually some police officers, they say privately, in the case of the police officers, and publicly with many of those other groups, that those powers aren't enough and that we need new powers to deal with this and to protect citizens in this city.
Councillor Jennings, you seconded the amendments. Do you want to speak now or are you reserving your...
I'm reserving my right.
Councillor Kennedy?
Just to underline some of the things Councillor Small said there, this is a very limited motion aimed at one kind of march, but I'd like to address my comments to the amendment made by Councillor Crowe. I don't know if you've ever read Dr. Carl Popper's work, Tom, but you don't defend the open society by giving in those who would impose tyranny. You defend the open society with all the firmness that the tyrant would use against you. Your motion, your amendment, is simply a capitulation to the racists and the bigots. If we're going to defend Liverpool people against tyrants, we will be firm in that resistance. I think Councillor Kemp said some very sensible things, some very things I would agree, but I disagree with the idea that ridicule is simply the way to win the argument. I could make some comment about a recent election where ridicule had very little impact. This is something in which we have to be completely firm. Just one item in this motion whose singular focus is to incite hatred through racism and bigotry. I don't find that a laughing matter, Councillor Kent. It is something which is ridiculous, but it is not something which can be defeated just by ridicule. And I certainly don't think I would want to defend the free speech of anybody who would want to bring that kind of feeling into my and our city.
Councillor.
I think both the motion and the amendments have actually been very considered and very useful, and it's sometimes a difficult balancing act to decide what our balance is right. The only particular reservations I have with the main motion, and maybe you might want to consider some drafting amendments to take into account, are two things. Firstly, it talks about city leaders, and I think that's a bit unfortunate because, to use the phrase, if a homophobic or a racist march was organised in Brighton, that's not a city. If we're asking for a legal review, I think we should have it for all parts of the country, not just the cities. And I know it's being debated in the city, but we are asking government to change legislation. It should consider for the whole country, not in parts. And we've seen sectarian or bigoted marches in not just the cities. We've seen them in some of the market towns, some of the shires, and therefore if we're going to ask for national legislation changes, we should take account of that. And you might want to consider drafting something, you know, just council leaders, if that's, that's your view, and I'd accept that. The other question, I think, is a judgment call. Do we believe council or political leaders should make the decision or instigate the decision to create a ban, when in fact there are clear legal parameters and there's case law on what's defining inciting hatred? And I think that inciting hatred should actually be broadened as racism. Inciting hatred has been now well defined in legal cases in the United Kingdom for some time, as it was previously in places like Canada and Australia. Now the question is, who would be better able to make that call and defend that judgment? I would suggest the chief constables, with the support of special branch who do monitor extreme groups, would be seen as more credible and more objective sources to make that judgment call. I have no doubt they will consult political leaders, but I think on preference, I would prefer it not to be made by politicians. But if it is by a judicial review of what it constitutes incitement to hatred and racism, then I think we'd be safer to have that done by chief constables, not just in cities, but throughout the country. And I will, with two minds, support the amendment, but I will support the main motion as put, because they both take us forward, and I think both are welcome. I thank members for their debate.
Councillor Rachel O'Brien.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. There was three really significant events that happened in Liverpool this summer that I think reflects our type of city and the people in our city. The first one was the Michael Corsa vigil, which came out of remembering a young man, a young LGBT man, who was brutally attacked in a bigoted homophobic assault. The second one was the Anthony Walker Festival, which celebrated the life and celebrated diversity and culture after the horrific murder of Anthony Walker in a bigoted attack. And the third was when a group of the so-called superior race tried to enter Liverpool and they didn't make it out of the left luggage department at Lime Street Station. Horrific things happening, trying to invade our city and the integrity and welcome of our city. And we come back in strong numbers and say, this is not acceptable, this is not what we want to stand for. I believe in free speech, but I also believe that you can't shout fire in a crowded theatre. I believe that as a city, we need to show a welcome and diverse, true reception for what our city is. And I feel that by allowing bigotry that seeks to invade the integrity of our city is just not acceptable, and we have to stand that out. And actually, councillors and the mayor are the representatives and the voice of the city. That's what representative democracy is, and it's for us to call out and shout it. So I think those three events were very important to our city, and it's even more important that we do not let those tiny minority of vicious, bigoted, homophobic, racist, sexist people try and say what they stand for and make a mark on our city.
Councillor Miller.
I'm not going to make a sensible suggestion related to either the amendment or the main motion, because actually I'm going to talk from the heart. I led the Pride March, and we walked through the rain, as we should, and we walked up past Derby Square, and the people from the Zion Tabernacle were shouting that we should burn in hell for what we do and who we are. But do you know what? That's all they did. We shouted back, and we ignored them in many cases. But when you see on Facebook, social media, in the press, that individuals from the White Man's March are being told to carry or to wear a big buckled belt, which apparently means wear a belt within the buckle there is a knife. Why would you want to wear a buckle with a knife? You're giving intention that you intend to do damage, whether you are going to do it or not. That's what you're saying. And in those instances, that's not about free speech. That's intention. And actually, we have every right as a city and as an individual to actually stand up and defend our own rights, but no matter who we are. Because one day, if we don't stand up, gay means you'll be burned to death in Uganda, and you'll be thrown from buildings. It's surreal. Now, the issue is, but is it here, or is it? Because one day it could be. And we actually, it's not about free speech, it's about actually, in law, people are not allowed to discriminate for your sexuality and for your colour and your faith, etc. But it's okay to walk through the streets and make threatening comments and intimidation and whatever. I don't want to see this city, and I was so proud to see the city come out and actually go into Lime Street and show those idiots exactly what kind of city this is. And it's a city that loves everybody, no matter where they're from and who they are, because that's who we are. And I'm proud to say that. As I say, I wasn't going to make a sensible contribution, but maybe an emotional one, because that's who we are. Thank you.
Thank you for that, Councillor. I was going to ask you, did you want to...
Well, I know it goes to the right to the motion, but I hope that I'm able to do the response to the amendment and the motion for the interval, because appealing to the Green Party to join the request. Clearly, they raised the concerns. First, let me deal with Councillor Kemp's points about the overreaction from the police. Our police have a difficult job. They cannot determine who turns up and who doesn't turn up, and they have to prepare for all eventualities. And that's why we should give nothing but praise to our police. But then let's deal with Councillor Radford's point about the police making the decision. The police shouldn't make decisions. The police are there to police the streets. That's their job. It's for politicians to decide, and then for public servants like the police, like the fire authority, to actually carry out that. And the protection is there that for any group that feels that we have acted unlawfully or whatever, to appeal to the Home Secretary. So all of that's enshrined and protected. And then we come to the Greens' point about the ability for the city to say that we shouldn't have a march and that we might expand that to others. Look, you can put in a constitution, but we need to get the Home Secretary to agree it. You can put in all kinds of mechanisms where, when we talk about city leaders, we're talking about party leaders, talk about not just the mayor, but people should have the right to do that. And let me tell you the reason why. And I think Malcolm's point about it not really being an effective response to this is for this reason. And it's the police's concerns, and you have to look at it from their concerns, from my concerns, from the city's concerns, as people want to go about their ordinary daily lives. We had a problem with not only White Man March, but we had problems with the extreme left. So it wasn't the main body of Unite Against Fascism, it was other people wearing masks. And what they did, or what they wanted to do in Lime Street, or any other part of the city, was play out their hatred towards each other, their antagonism towards each other, on the streets of our city. People need to be able to go about doing the business and shopping. Businesses need to be able to. Lime Street was locked down. Young people witnessed an assault on somebody. People seen that. It's not right. It's not right. It's not fair. It isn't something that we should allow to happen. If they want to come in, they want to threaten to come in, we should be able to threaten them back, not when you are doing what you are doing. And the problem for the police, and the problem for me, and the problem for everybody, is that we have the extremes on one side and the extremes on the other side, wanting to fight and play that type of game on the streets of Liverpool, and we're not prepared to do it. Remember what I also said about the people that we have responsibility, who are frightened. People frightened to come into town. BME members, whether they're from the LGBT community or anybody else, frightened to come into town because they don't know how many people are turning up. We didn't, on the first one, when the 12 turned up, we didn't know whether it was going to be 400 turned up. The police with their intelligence couldn't tell. But the reality is, we should have that right in our city to say no. And then if they want an appeal, let them appeal. And if the Home Secretary turns it round, that's fine. And those covenants, those things are in my motion. That text talks about the protection of freedom of speech and the protection of the Home Secretary to intervene. So I hope you reconsider and you actually back and support the motion, and all in this council say and support everybody in this city say it's not in our name.
Can I bring the Chief Executive then to give a clarification?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Given Mayor Anderson's comments, could I just test whether it's the wish of Mayor Anderson, but also Councillor Crowe, to see whether we can get some unanimity on the drafting of this particular resolution. If that is the case, and obviously it's your call, if that is the case, we'll have to take that away tonight entirely up and circulate around again tomorrow. But if that's the commitment to get unanimity, then that's what we'll
So this would require like a revisiting after this meeting, and we adjourn the decision for the time being.
I think I need to be helpful, Chief Executive. No, I'm asking for the Greens to remove the and withdraw the amendment.
what I am prepared to do is listen to what Councillor Radford said, listen to what Councillor Kemp said, listen to what Councillor Crowley said, and see if we can draft up. Because don't forget, our motion tonight is called on the Home Secretary. There is absolutely no doubt that the Home Secretary will want to respond to that. We'll see what she says. There is no doubt that if she agrees that something needs to move, that she will want discussions. And then we can put in arrangements or whatever to make sure that there's protection and so around freedom of speech. But in the first instance, I want to say to the people of this city, the vast majority of you don't want this to happen again. And we're listening to you, and we've acted upon your demands for us to say we don't want this in our city in their name.
Councillor Crone, are you going to withdraw your amendment?
I think given the level of passion and the fact, given the fact that we basically all agree on the substance here, that experiencing these sort of things on our streets is just so distasteful. And given that the Mayor, you know, is willing to enter into a dialogue to make sure that we sort of are all happy with the protections that can be put in place, we will draw the motion, the amendment.
Councillor Radford.
I'm very grateful for that, Mayor, and I'm just wondering if the Mayor would agree to city leaders being changed to council leaders so that when we are looking for a review of national legislation, we're preventing the nonsense of them just trying to march on the board with items just to escape the law. And I think that would help our case in getting the legislation changed. If that...
Could I ask Councillor Kemp, is he willing to join the unanimity of the council chair?
Indeed, I think that's the best way to
go. Okay, so the vote is on the main motion. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Can we move on now to item 8, and could I invite Mayor Anderson to move the motion standing in his name?
Can I reserve my right to be the seconder?
I mentioned it in the announcements. I just wanted to make it absolutely clear around this whole debate and give people here in the council chamber some facts about what we already do as a city in regards to supporting refugees. As I said before, we accommodate now, today, 1,800 asylum seekers in the city of Liverpool. At one time, and sometimes you have to do things in a way that is sort of covert, and you do that because you don't want to inflame things or give the wrong impression. Myself and officers have met with the Home Office and discussed with the Home Office the concerns about the government's changes to deal with asylum seekers. They've closed down dispersal centres. There's now only two, operating in the country. So, asylum seekers who are appealing against the judgment that they've lost their appeal come to Liverpool for their final appeal. And my concern, and we've had conversations with the Home Office, is that when people arrive here, we don't know whether they're part of a family, we don't know whether they're on their own, but when they come to the city of Liverpool and they lose their appeal, they'll have appealed three times before that. This is the final appeal. If they've got no money, they stay here in Liverpool and present as homeless. And not only do we don't know how many there are, The government don't know how many there are. The figures that we've got, the government and the Home Office actually give out figures and tell us that in this index that they have, this percentage index about what cities should accommodate in terms of one per 200 people who live in that city. We are 80% near the maximum with our 1,800. 50% more than Greater Manchester, 30% more than Birmingham, more than any other city. The only one who gets near us is Glasgow. So when we say that we're doing our best and when we say that we're doing what we're doing, we mean it. But the reality is, of course, this is a humanitarian crisis. It's one that is deeply shocking and deeply moving, and we all have to do things. And that's why, reading some of the amendments, it's important that you know that, you know, again, this isn't leadership theory, this is leadership in practice. We're actually talking to the Home Office and saying to them that we will accommodate people, we will accommodate Syrian refugees, but we need that support. We're equally working with the LGA, we're working with other leaders to say that the funding that's given to us, the funding that's given to Liverpool, should be made directly to Liverpool and not to SECO, the private sector, who aren't interested in particular where asylum seekers are dispersed, refugees are dispersed. And it's up to us to rightly say that we want control over that. Because we've got a responsibility for community cohesion, we've got a responsibility for the people that we already can't provide services to. So it's important as well that we say to governments who are talking about the refugees being able to be here for 5 years, we're only willing to give financial support for 1 year, that that's not good enough. We want a commitment to 5 years of funding. Now for me, I'm not going to, you know, talk about an amendment that asks me or talks to me about doubling that number to 200 or 300. If we get the funding and we get the support from government, we can clearly accommodate more than that. We can. But it has to be, and that caveat has to be made strongly, that it has to come with the resources enabling us to be able to look after those people. It costs us now about £1.7 million, I mentioned it before, to look after asylum seekers. That's over 1% or thereabouts, or it's around 1% of our council tax. We will do more to help people, but we need to get that support. And so that's why the motion mentions everything, and I don't think that amendments actually add anything to that. They really don't. And so, you know, for me, we need to engage with government, we need to talk to government, because you're right, everybody in this room who's witnessing those scenes know that this country, the United Kingdom, on its own can't do it. We also know that other countries are doing more than we are. And that's why it has to be a multifaceted approach, if you like, a cocktail of different things, the United Nations, the European Union, America, the Arab states themselves next door, all need to step up to the plate and do something. It's a crisis that the world has never seen before. But in terms of what we can do, we'll do not only what we can do. As a city, we're proud to always do more than that. We always have, and we always will. And that's why, you know, we've never made a big thing out of it about the numbers that we accommodate or the costs that it costs us. We just get on with doing it and trying to make it work. But we have to protect everybody within the city and at the same time offer open our arms to people who desperately need our support. So I hope everybody again recognises the motion for what it is and gets behind it, and I don't think there really should be any room for any amendments.
Councillor Radford, you've got Got an amendment?
I wish to move amendment standing my name, my Lord Mayor.
Is it seconded?
I would second that.
If I may speak to the amendment, I've very much considered and listened to the Mayor's commentary. Certainly, in fact and fairness, there are certain communities in the city that actually exceed the Home Office guidelines in housing a number of refugees, and some district A considerably, that was it was the right thing to do, and some of that view I took in my own ward because it actually enables to tackle some of the blights belonging to a derelict property which had been renovated. I'd also concur with the Mayor's view about Serco hasn't been as responsive and has been as coordinated in supporting the refugees in the community from having the city. Certainly, I tried to get Serco to put up posters like Stop Hate Crime UK and provide community facilities made known to refugee houses, and I have to say the response was quite markedly disappointing. So I share that. But I hope the Labour group might be minded to support at least some of the points in the amendment on moving. Because I think we've not only just got to talk to government, we've actually got to talk to the wider population and tackle some of the apprehensions they have by some positive changes. I know, having put on community meals for asylum seekers, and I was quite astonished by how few came. So I went round to some of the asylum houses in my ward. I was personally horrified the amount of allowance they were expected to live in. Could not comprehend how someone could cater themselves on the allowances asylum seekers were expected to do. And not surprisingly, they were actually quite forthcoming. Virtually every asylum seeker I visited in the houses said they were working illegally because they couldn't survive. They would starve on the allowances they were given. One asylum seeker was working at a car wash for £10 a day because £10 was better than starving. And that is happening throughout the city. And we can't blame asylum seekers because we've set up the legal system where they can't work while their applications are being considered. So I'm suggesting that if we want to attack the illegal exploitation of asylum seekers, we should allow them to work. And it will give them dignity as well as an income. Secondly, it will enable those who do get asylum status to actually become more integrated in British society, which is in everyone's interest, because we all believe in cohesion. And it will also mean they start creating credits like national insurance and pensions and unemployment, and they contribute to the economy. It will also mean that someone will be able to pay for their own housing costs rather than living sometimes good housing, others not. And the other reason to say it...
Councillor Bradford, you have to wind up.
If I may, yes, just be very brief.
The red light's on.
Just one example. I had a Libyan doctor in my ward who wanted to work voluntarily at a local hospital. He couldn't do so. He wanted to thank the UK by working for free. He lived in September Road. And our system wouldn't allow him to contribute. What a disgrace. If you want the asylum community to be accepted and contribute, we can do it, and we can get rid of some of the negative perceptions. They deserve dignity, and they want to contribute, and we are foolish, and we are actually creating problems in not doing so. So I urge members to support the amendment.
Councillor Spurrell.